War is repulsive business. In Ethiopia, the political calamity between the federal government in Addis Ababa and the regional government in Tigray has turned violent. Military forces have been deployed and the fighting has involved tanks, jets, and artillery. Now, however, after weeks of fighting, the conflict is about to transform into an inter-ethnic war. Citizens are being forced to reconsider their loyalties to their ethnic kin or the unity of the state. As these irreversible lines are being drawn, the room for de-escalation is diminishing rapidly. Time is of the utmost urgency, and at stake is nothing less than the integrity of Ethiopia. I'm your host Shirvan, and welcome to Caspian Report. Today's episode is made possible by NordVPN, which is a tool that hides your IP and reduces your digital footprint. The app is perfect for those working from home, but it works on mobile devices just as well. NordVPN is affordable and user-friendly. Just go to nordvpn.com/caspianreport and use the promo code CaspianReport to get a discount on the premium version. Ethiopia is like a mosaic, a large nation made up of smaller pieces with different colors and shapes held together by artificial means. It has all the attributes of a regional powerhouse, but its single greatest vulnerability has always been sectarianism. No less than 80 distinct ethnicities call Ethiopia their home, with the two largest being the Oromo and the Amhara, who account for roughly 32% and 28% of the population respectively. Other ethnic groups worth mentioning are the Tigray and the Somali, who each represent another 6.5% of the people. Additionally, there are 9 ethnic groups that have over 1 million members, and the population can be further split along its 2 dominant religions, Islam and Christianity. If that wasn't complicated enough, the ethno-religious communities are spread interchangeably across a vast and rugged terrain where the federal government has always struggled to exercise its control. As a result, ethnic insurgencies have been a near constant occurrence throughout Ethiopian history. For most of the 20th century, the country was governed by an Amhara-dominated monarchy. But in 1991, a new coalition came to power, political reforms followed, and a new federal system was designed to pacify the largest ethnic groups. However, the plan was deeply flawed. Dozens of minority groups were left unrepresented and overshadowed by the regional majorities. A disproportionate system emerged where the leadership hailing from the Tigray province monopolized Ethiopian politics at the federal level. In the next 3 decades, the Tigray power brokers ruled over the country, oftentimes ruthlessly and corruptly. They retained exclusive rights to Ethiopia's economy, its natural resources, and the billions of dollars in international aid and loans. In 2018, Abiy Ahmed, who himself had Oromo, Amhara, Muslim, and Christian roots, ascended to power. Under his leadership, a coalition government was formed that included new power brokers as well as old. Ethiopia turned from failure to success. Political prisoners were freed, state enterprises were privatized, and a historic peace agreement was signed with neighboring Eritrea. These swift transformations earned Abiy a Nobel Peace Prize in 2019. But once the honeymoon was over, the coalition government turned on itself. You see, much of the reforms had come at the expense of the Tigray influence. So much so that in just 2 years, Tigray lawmakers found themselves in the backseat of the coalition that they had previously dominated. Then, Abiy came with a new proposal to replace the coalition party with a political party of his own. The Tigray faction, however, refused to take part in the new political stream because they would lose their remaining sway over the federal government. This then brings us to the current political crisis. Abiy wants to centralize power in Addis Ababa while his Tigray counterparts seek to retain their first-class influence in Ethiopian politics. Since these developments, which have simmered over the past 2 years, the political rhetoric has gone from bad to worse. Secession, is now the topic of conversation in the Tigray province. Now, to be clear, Abiy did not create this problem. He inherited it. Nevertheless, his handling of the stalemate made the situation worse. For instance, he postponed the general elections scheduled for 2020, citing the coronavirus pandemic as the reason. Tigray lawmakers called the delay unconstitutional and held regional elections anyway. Then, the Abiy government refused to recognize the elections and cut off the Tigray regional government from federal funding. With neither side recognizing the other, something was bound to trigger a fight. So, when Abiy sought to reshuffle the leadership of the Tigray-based Northern Command, the Tigray leadership saw it as a coup and rejected the attempt. What followed next is murky due to the media blackout, but someone attacked a post belonging to the Northern Command, which triggered a series of tit-for-tat attacks. The result was that a proportion of the heavily armed Northern Command defected to the Tigray regional government. There were some attempts to mediate the situation, but Abiy rejected them and launched an offensive into the Tigray province with the aim to dismantle the regional leadership. Now, it's important to note that Abiy's offensive was and is primarily directed against the political military establishment in Tigray, not against the ethnic Tigray population. However, as the fighting has dragged on, the conflict has steadily taken on a more ethnically driven narrative. This is dangerous because at a certain point, ethnic Tigrays will feel marginalized in Ethiopia and thus sympathetic to the flight of the Tigray regional government. If that happens, if this political crisis turns into an ethnic conflict, the fight ahead will be a protracted one. The making of that ethnic narrative is already in play. For example, Abiy's offensive enjoys strong support in Ethiopia's Amhara region, and Amhara special forces have played a crucial role in the initial offensive. There are also indications of ethnic profiling by the Ethiopian federal government, which is why many Tigray government employees, particularly military personnel, have resigned from their posts and are in the process of resettling to the Tigray province. Who is to blame is uncertain, but if the current battle becomes a conflict against the Tigray population at large, it will spell disaster for Ethiopia proper. The fallout of a lengthy sectarian conflict will be costly, complicated, and bloody. Ethiopia is a mountainous country. It's not an easy place to wage war, not even for Ethiopians themselves. Its rugged geography is one of the reasons why Ethiopia has never been successfully colonized by outsiders, and for what it's worth, the Ethiopians have never successfully centralized their state for the same reasons. If Ethiopian forces move deeper into the steep and hilly terrain of the Tigray landscape, the Tigray regional government will be able to muster more manpower and firepower. That would raise the stakes substantially, particularly for outlying powerhouses. Since the Tigray province is landlocked, much of its logistics go through Ethiopia proper or Eritrea, but these supply chains have been unavailable since the start of the conflict. If the Tigray leadership can establish a logistical connection with Sudan, it could find new sources to resupply itself with military and humanitarian goods. This makes Sudan the single most decisive factor in the conflict. And whatever is the outcome of the war, Khartoum is likely to emerge stronger than before. Egypt, meanwhile, will also want to take advantage of the turmoil and extract concessions from Ethiopia on its Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. Cairo is concerned that the hydropower project along the Blue Nile will limit its water flow from the Nile, so the Egyptians will likely team up with the Sudanese and use the unrest in Ethiopia to delay or derail the controversial hydropower project. In neighboring Somalia, things are a bit more complicated. Ethiopia has withdrawn its peacekeeping operations in Somalia, which has left Mogadishu inherently more vulnerable to jihadist attacks. On the other hand, ethnic Somalis make up a sizable proportion of Ethiopia, and irredentist claims could once again take hold in the Ogaden region. Either way, a destabilizing Horn of Africa will invite Turkey as a geopolitical stabilizer. Both Somalia and Ethiopia have close relations with Turkey, and the Turks have an interest in weakening their Egyptian counterparts by using the Nile as a point of leverage. Of course, once the Turks get involved, the Saudis, the Iranians, the Qataris, and the Emirates will not remain far behind. And before you know it, the Tigray conflict is globalized. For now, neither the Ethiopian federal government nor the Tigray regional government is likely to enter the negotiations because they enjoy enough political support to continue the fight. But the longer the war rages, the greater the odds that foreign players will enter the battle space. So it is in the interest of Addis Ababa to resolve the fight as soon as possible before it becomes an international conflict or before it takes on an ethnically driven dimension. If the hostilities are prolonged, the Tigray province will not be the only area seeking to break away. The southern nations, nationalities, and people's province is teeming with multiple secessionist movements, with some ethnic groups campaigning for referendums for self-determination. Meanwhile, the Oromo, Valega, and Benishangul regions, where a low-intensity conflict is currently being waged, are also looking to reinvigorate their separatist movements. Consequently, in Ethiopia, all eyes are fixed on the Tigray conflict. If the Tigray regional government succeeds, other Ethiopian regions could reject Abiy's centralization policy with similar concessions. So, a lot is riding on the outcome of this conflict. It could either make or break the mosaic that is Ethiopia. I've been your host Shirvan from Caspian Report. If you like what we do, please leave a like, comment, and subscribe. Thank you for watching, and Saul.